Have you ever had a leader or one of your supervisors task you with a job and ask you to do something, and you find yourself sitting there with a blank look on your face and not knowing what those next steps should be?
Well, yes, Joy, I've had that exact same blank stare on my face. But don't you agree that the more a leader prepares you for that kind of situation, that it makes it much easier not to have that happen?
Absolutely. What I've found, and Ray has found, whether it's corporations, being coached by someone in the military, in all these different facets of our lives, we have found leaders that show these five things that we're going to talk about today and have a conversation with you about were things that we really feel help that culture go to the next level or that organization. So one of the things, like you said, for preparation was always being very prepared for that next step. So the leader that comes in and gives you those clear, concise goals and the objectives and instructions, and you're not sitting there wondering, what's the next step? What am I supposed to do? We feel that those leaders, you don't waste time. You get right into that job. And one of the analogies I want to give you is going back into the military time when I was down in Pensacola and going through different steps. There were definite times I sat there with that blank look on my face, whether it was doing something in the water or meteorology learning or something in that. But when it came to emergency procedures or some of the steps by step, the leaders that took us through that or our simulators instructors that pointed out things in that sim left me very prepared. And no doubt when I ever had an emergency, I was ready to react.
Now, from your time in the Navy, how did you develop that trust that your leader was preparing you in the correct way?
One of the things that I think in that preparation is a leader that goes in, and as we've consulted, we've seen it in the opposite way in some leaders, that they know that we're human, we're going to make a mistake, that every once in a while we don't get it right the first time. So if we go in and we have that opportunity to basically prepare and keep learning, that's that key to the, because you're okay getting in there and learning and keep practicing till it's more perfect, right?
Right. So it had to be a effective communication style that kind of helps you to understand exactly what your leader wanted from you, right?
Absolutely. And we got a lot of that in the military, that effective communication. There was no doubt what you're supposed to do next and no surprises. We always say we teach personnel, and when we go into companies, definitely say be flexible. Be flexible out there, but try not to make your personnel always have to be flexible. Don't surprise them all the time. Help them go to that next step. And then the next thing we always said was that personal connection, but we added a professional personal connection, that when you have personnel, everybody's motivated differently. From, you know, the coaching, you coach a lot. We've seen it in corporations. And as a mom, I have twin boys, and my twins are 14 years old. And what I've found as a mom, as they've grown up, although they were born on the same day, I raised them, I think, my husband and I, pretty similarly. We worked, you know, with them as they grew up. They are motivated completely different. What works on one, and Ray, you know them both, does not, and you've coached them both.
Right.
They are motivated completely different. So we carry that into work.
Does that translate outside of the home and into organizations as well?
Absolutely. It's the know your people. And we always say, what makes them tick? So if you can figure out that next step of when you think of from a child to someone on a field, I think of my soccer team at the Naval Academy, we were all motivated a little differently. We had different positions. So just know what makes your personnel tick.
So what was one of the biggest benefits, the things that you learned as being on a team in the Navy?
Being on the team, practice. So that brings us to that next step with, we've heard practice makes perfect, but we want the leaders to take it to that next level of creating a culture of learning. You're always learning. Like my sister's a vet. I have a brother that's a clinical psychologist, a sister and a brother that are dentists, and they're always talking about their C's, their continued education. And I think even if your organization's not requiring that, that you are always creating that culture of learning, whether it's in any facet, whether it's safety or procedures, whatever it is, you're constantly learning.
Now, you talked about practice, but what exactly is practice? Practice is the performance of an activity or skill repeatedly to improve or maintain one's proficiency. Now, I know you all heard the quote, we are what we continuously do. Like, excellence is not just the action, but it's also the habit. So we want to create good habits. When we create good habits, we lead to things like productivity and greater performance. And greater performance leads to greater success. And success is like that train that goes 200 miles an hour down the track and doesn't have brakes. So it doesn't stop, it's unstoppable. It builds that momentum. And once you have that momentum, it's hard to stop. It's the only person that can stop that momentum is you. Now, what else do we need once we have that momentum, that success, that productivity from practice, from practicing good habits? We need persistence. Persistence, what is persistence?
Well, persistence, the example I gave you about soccer at the Naval Academy, our coaches used to make us do penalty kick after penalty kick after penalty kick to nauseam. And it got to the point where, can we do some other drills or can we play whatever game? And they would do it over and over. And what we'd quickly find out is you would get down to a big game wherever we traveled to, and it was 3-3, 2-2. And it came down to that penalty kick, that, you know, that high stress, the audience is loud. And I thanked my coach for putting us through that practice, persistence, constant. And yes, we're not always going to be in that game-winning shot or that life or death situation, but the more you practice,
right? When you practice, you create that confidence. That confidence is that muscle memory that you can react to high stress situations without having to think about it. Your body just reacts. Now we do it in sports and boxing all the time, but in a corporate situation, when you have high stress levels, it's much easier to function if you've practiced and you know you have that skill. Now when you do that, the persistence is that will not to give up, the will not to just be complacent and think that just because you've gotten to a certain level that everything needs to stop. You have to continue that. Now, if we go back and look at the preparation, the professional and personal connection, the practice of good habits, the productivity and performance, which equals success, and the persistence, those are the building blocks to effective leadership. Now, once you have those building blocks for effective leadership, do you think that can translate into any other situation, Joy?
Absolutely, because if you start looking at these five things that we were talking about, you naturally build this mutual respect with your personnel. They trust you, you trust them. You know that, okay, I might make a mistake, but I'm going to learn from that mistake and move on. There's that environment of trust that's built, and where that carries over into that we've seen in studying cultures and organizations is it also falls into diversity inclusion, high-risk behavior prevention. There's a level of knowing your personnel. You recognize signs. You're basically there with your people.
Now, you're a naval aviator. You have a doctorate in organizational development, and you're a master's in psychology. So can you explain it to me like I'm a six-year-old?
Absolutely. With one of the things, Ray and I love analogies. We talk about, even on the sports field, giving people an example. And one of the things we've seen with diversity and inclusion and talking to audiences about this topic, we've used the game Jenga. If any of you have ever played Jenga, it's the game that has the wooden pieces and you pull them out one by one. And what we found is, as the game's being played, whether you're at your house or a group, you pull out the pieces one by one, and what happens when it crashes and makes all the noise?
Crashes down and you draw the attention of everybody. Now, if the organization doesn't have a strong base and you don't have that base protected, then it's gonna be chaos all over. When you have chaos, you don't have productivity. When you have chaos, you don't have confidence in your leadership. So you have to protect that base at all times and put good things in and not just pull out every single thing and make it the structure weaker.
And we're saying, like, each of those pieces in that Jenga puzzle, if you think of it like a person in the organization, part of that team, if the leader, supervisor, I think of, you know, my commands in the military, or whether it's corporate or on a soccer team or of the track team, if someone makes a comment, a joke that's, and I'm not talking about something that's funny, we both love to joke around, it's the intent of what they're saying, and it's an inappropriate comment or something in the workplace that's offensive, that person comes out and it makes, you've got to think of it, it's making that base that you talked about unsteady. And so when we think of the leader that goes through these type of things and has that trust built with their personnel, you almost got to think of them as wrapping their arms around that base and protecting it and keeping it stable. And Ray and I always talk about, yes, things happen to these commands or corporations. What do we do as someone that's in that organization watching this? You're the person that's pushing that piece back in. You know, you're keeping it strong and steady.
Well, things are going to happen. We're human, right?
Right.
So every single organization, whether it's at home, whether it's in a team situation, whether it's an organization, things are going to happen. You're going to get that monkey in your back. Sometimes it feels like an ape. When I tell everybody to control your ape. And when you control your ape is your attitude, your preparation, and your effort. Those are things that you can control no matter what's going on around you. Your attitude, like, you might get up for work one day and say, oh, I'm tired. I don't want to go to work. But if you have that attitude every single morning that, oh man, I get the opportunity to go to work. I get the opportunity to do something great for someone else. It changes your perspective. Now, preparation is one of the first things that we talked about. Now, preparation makes you feel confident because you've practiced it. You know things over and over again. So you can control that, how prepared you are for every single situation. And then the effort, that's kind of the hardest thing to deal with, because everybody talks about the action, but the debate about the action is not the action itself. So you have to put that effort towards it. And once you have that effort and you have all these things together, it makes you feel much more confident, and that creates confidence around you, which creates productivity.
Which is that persistence where the leader has given you that opportunity to control your ape. They've believed in you, they've trusted in you, and then you put in the effort, and it's a beautiful thing. I say it's an unstoppable team. They work together. And that goes into, we talked about diversity and inclusion, but all the high-risk behaviors, the high-risk behavior prevention, it's the same thing. We talk about knocking out a knockout. You're very familiar with a clear knockout. Your dad was an Olympic boxer, legendary. You won every fight you boxed in.
Yeah, I understand the principle of knockout. Knockout is what? Stopping behavior in its tracks.
Exactly.
So my definition of a knockout may be a little bit different than yours.
Absolutely not, because I think that when you stop a knockout, knock something out in its tracks, it's the end. There's no, it is eradicated. And so that's the other thing, is getting leaders to think about it as a knockout. Don't have it at all.
Right. And that's what we want to do for high-risk behavior, to stop it in its tracks. And I think the principles that we discussed, we talked about the preparation, the professional, personal connection, the practice of good habits, the productivity and performance and the persistence can translate to every single thing. And if you have that good base as an organization, you're going to be successful. You know, you take it down, like in the Navy, you had what? Dignity, honor, courage, commitment.
Yeah, and we say that if you can remember, want to say just in closing that if you think of your team and your personnel, how you want to be treated, and I remember one of the guys in one of my commands, when I checked in as the only female, he asked me, I'm nervous. I don't know what to say to you because I feel like I'm going to say the wrong thing. And I said, if you remember these things, which we talk about in every speech, dignity and respect, treat people with respect. You know, treat them the way you would want to be treated. You're not going to go wrong. Don't make it harder than it is when you go in. You have, new people coming into a command. And I know there's other things that go into that, but we always say, don't make it harder than it is. Really remember these things.
Awesome. You're awesome.
You're awesome.
Thank you.
Wow.